Okay, so let us have a look at backpropagation through time and the issues that it brings about when we use it for training neural networks. In the case of vanilla backpropagation, we made use of computational graph. That was the computational graph of a feedforward neural network. And remember that this way of representing the network or the underlying computations is based on the textbook, Dive into Deep Learning. I think we don't have to go there in too much detail because we essentially just did it in the previous session. Just remember, we see the different computational steps clearly depicted here, and then we can make use of these steps in order to first of all nail down what are the relevant derivatives that we need. For example, if we want to update the weights in the weight matrix W superscript 2, which connects the hidden and the output layer in our neural network, we have to go in a backward way through the computations. The loss depends on the loss function. The loss function L here depends on our network output, y hat, which in itself is a function of the weight matrix W superscript 2 and the hidden state. And we can walk back through the network, always paying attention to the computational steps to work out the update equations that we need for gradient descent. That was the core of backpropagation, right? And it's written down here based on the textbooks for your convenience, just to familiarize yourself. As I said, essentially, we just did it in the previous session. Maybe one note that the notation I'm using here based on the textbook with this prot operator, this guy here. That's kind of a convenience operator. If we train our neural network using mini batch gradient descent, we feed the network a bunch of training data points, and so we have multiple loss values, and it's all about vectors and matrices that we are dealing with. That also follows from the notation with the boldface indicating a vector if it's a small script letter and a matrix if it's a capital letter. And this plot operator is to say that we are carrying out multiplication of these vectors and matrices and ensure that everything is proper, that the dimensions of these matrices and vectors work out and that we transpose wherever needed. So just the convenient function. The key thing is that, for instance, if we want to update the weights in our hidden to output layer matrix W superscript 2, we essentially need for that the derivative of the cost function with regard to y hat, our network output, and the derivative of y hat with regard to the weights W superscript 2, and likewise. And we can also write down a computational graph for a recurrent neural network to inform our doing in backpropagation through time. And the computational graph, first of all, it's a good exercise to reason how would the computational graph look like in a recurrent neural network. And of course, we have the picture. Here it is. I'm considering a sequence of three elements. So we have t equal to 1, equal to 2, and equal to 3. And hence, we've got x1, 2, and 3, y1, 2, and 3, and network outputs y hat 1, y hat 2, and y hat 3. And the corresponding hidden states, h1, h2, h3, plus the initial hidden state, ho. And we see a lot more errors here in this picture. The far right side is pretty easy. It's just saying that our loss measure, our loss j, is basically a function of the individual losses that we observe when letting our network predict or output a prediction every time step, or every word in the case of language modeling. And we will again need the derivative of the loss with regard to y hat. We also see the dependence on of y hat on the weights w8y and on the hidden state h. And the key part here is noting how the hidden state h depends on the previous hidden state. Obviously, we know that from the update equation, but we can also depict it visually in the computational graph, where this dependence takes the form of these arrows here. That's the dependence of the hidden state on previous hidden state. And it's what is causing us some trouble. And I will take it as in the case of backpropagation, where we sketch the main principles in a slightly simplified example, namely the example of a linear latent variable model. Strictly speaking, what you see here in this computational graph already is a linear latent variable model or vector autoregression. And the reason why this is so is I am not distinguishing between the input signal into a unit or a cell or a neuron and its output signal. I'm not distinguishing that. We have H3, but we do not distinguish between the input and the output, which is the input times the nonlinear activation function, which is yet a different computational step that we would need to add to our computational graph if we want to make the picture really, really precise. So this H is a function of G of Z, right? We don't have that here. Well, I'll take it away soon because it is absolutely unrelated to the red arrows that I have drawn on the slide. It's just to say that this distinction between H and Z, we don't see that in the graph, so it's just not there. It's not there. Let's erase it. It's not there. So that is already the simplified case, and here is the simplified case in mathematical notation. We have our linear latent variable model, where the latent variable ht depends on the observable xt and the previous latent state ht minus 1, and where both these observable and previous hidden state get weighted with corresponding weight matrices wxh and whh. Well, you have seen that equation many times. And let's try now to write down some equations for the relevant gradients. Now, to that end, the first thing we need is some measure of the loss. And for now, I'll leave it with the general case where I'm just using this L symbol here for my loss measure. Could be the squared error loss or cross entropy. In the vast majority of cases, it's going to be one of these two. And the relevant derivatives, previously I said, let's write down the relevant derivatives. What is relevant here? Well, relevant is any derivative that we need, or partial derivative for that matter, that we need to calculate the gradient update, that we need for our gradient descent. So it's the cost function with regard to the weights that are relevant. And we have three sets of weights, or three weight matrices, WHY, WHH, and WXH. So these three derivatives is what we really need to do backpropagation in our linear latent variable model. So let's give it a try, right? We can look at the computational graph for start and then try to get going. The first one is fairly easy. The derivative of the derivative of delta j with regard to the hidden to output weights, WHY. That's the first one we need.
So the first part in the computation is our measure of loss, which might be the squared error loss, or it could be cross entropy, one of these two in the vast majority of cases. And from there on, the next computational node or the next step in our calculation is our forecast y hat. And we have three of these because we believe or we assume that we update our, or that we generate forecasts in every step of our sequential computation. So as in a feedforward neural network, we need the derivative of the loss function with regard to y hat. And y hat itself is a function that depends on other functions. We need to apply the chain rule, and examining the independence of y hat on previous computations, we see from this multiplication, which is denoted by the gray ball with the x element y the multiplication, we see how we have two key ingredients, one being the weight matrix connecting the hidden to the output layer WHY. That's affecting our loss calculations, and also we have the effect of the hidden layer output, which is H. That also goes in this computation of Y hat. And this would be enough as long as we are interested in updating the weights that connect the hidden to the output layer. Hence, this is the best starting point because it's the easiest derivative. And you see it here. Remember, this operator prot is a convenient function which ensures that since I'm working with matrices and vectors here, all the dimensions are proper and the operations like doing a transpose or something are applied as suitable. So we essentially see the derivative of our loss with regard to our forecast, y hat, and in addition, we see ht here in the derivative, where ht essentially is coming from the output equation, and specifically it is the derivative of our forecast with regard to the weight matrix WHY. If you write it down like that, everything fits nicely together and makes sense where these terms are coming from. So for completeness, I should also basically indicate this dependence here. We have delta J of W with regard to delta Y hat. That's where this term is coming from. And I don't write it down explicitly, or I don't spell it out, because it depends on the measure of loss that we are using. For squared error loss, it's just the residual, as you know, y hat t minus y t. So that is particularly easy, but for the cross entropy function, we could also just work out the loss as we go along. And that really gives us the first derivative. What do we need as part of the gradient descent, or as part of backpropagation? That's one of the derivatives that we depend on. So let's look at the next one. It's a bit more complicated. Here we have the derivative of the cost function J with regard to the matrix WHH that operates in the hidden layer. And the derivative begins in the very same manner as before, namely with delta A with regard to delta Y hat. And then the next factor in this product is the derivative of our forecast Y hat with regard to ht. That's the main difference from the previous derivative that we were examining. Let me make sure I'm using the right color. We are once more basing the middle block in our factor on the output equation, but this time, since we are looking for the derivative of the cost function with regard to the hidden layer weight matrix, we need delta yt with regard to delta y, sorry, delta why. Sorry, me being confused, it's delta ht, the derivative with regard to delta ht, which is the weight matrix why. And if we examine the computational graph, as we should do, as I should have done, then it's also quite clear that we need to consider this ht here as determinant. But that's not the end of the story. Since now we have the derivative of y hat with regard to ht, ht itself, well, that is a function. So there is another nesting of functions going on that we need to take account of. And what you see here as the last factor in our derivative is delta ht with regard to the weights matrix delta whh. So finally, we have found the last factor that we need to do the derivative of the cost function with regard to the hidden layer weights. And we see how this involves ht. And to be honest, that's not the end of the story, but for now, I would like to leave it like that. We will very soon resolve this last factor here. That's the one that will cause us some problems, but please be patient for a little longer before we resolve that. Let's just leave it for now. And instead, let's have a quick look at the last derivative that we need until we have everything we need for our gradient update. The last derivative which we need is the one of the cost function with regard to the weight matrix that connects the input to the hidden layer. And the first blocks are exactly as before. We see our loss function, the derivative of the loss with regard to the forecast. We then see the derivative of the forecast with regard to the hidden state. That bit here, right? That's previously I did it wrongly, so maybe I can do it again. So that's correct. Now it's correct. And well, if we go further back and want to update eventually the weights in the input layer, we need to consider the dependence, and I should use a different color for that. We should consider the dependence of ht, which is in fact a function of the input, but the input is constant xh. And this is what you see right here. That's the last piece of the puzzle. However, again, in the equation that we are working with, in the update equation of the hidden layer, we are a bit superficial. We are a bit sloppy, if you wish, because we could not leave the derivative as that delta ht with regard to delta whxh, or before we had delta ht with regard to whh. What really is that? What's that derivative? We are missing something here. And a look at the update equation tells us what we are missing. We haven't really talked about this bit here. Ht is a recursive function. It depends on ht minus 1. So intuitively, if all our partial derivatives are basically resulting from applying the chain rule, and we have ht depending on ht minus 1, we need to take account of that dependence. And this is what we left out so far, so let's have a look at that. It's not yet defined, this bit and these bits. This is what we need, and from the update equation, we do see that the hint state depend on each other, or more specifically on previous steps, and therefore we need to ask how the hint state affects a future hint state in order to get the derivative right. And noting that they do depend on one another, so, well, here is the answer. We do need delta ht plus 1 with regard to delta ht. It's part of the chain rule computations that we are performing here. We need this dependence. It's clearly highlighted in the computational graph, right? Here it is again. Here's the dependence. And we haven't really yet taken account of that in our derivative. And doing the derivative is actually very easy, because looking at the update equation, finding the derivative ht plus 1 with regard to ht, that's simply whh. That was the easy part. But, well, the hidden state ht in itself depends on the previous state ht minus 1. So there is recursion here in the calculations of this derivative. And this means that if we consider the entire sequence, which may have its origin, or which does have its origin at h0, and then there are a certain number of steps, overall, we obtain this term delta h capital T with regard to delta h small t. Small t is the current time step, and capital T, I should write that down. So this is capital T, okay? That's the max length of my sequence. In the computational graph shown below, it's 3. It's only 3 steps, because we have 3 inputs, x1 to 3. And it could be much longer, right? So this computation that we see here, the weight matrix WHH, or the transpose of it, multiplied with itself over capital T minus small t steps. The key take home here is that we multiply this weight matrix with itself for as many steps as our sequence is long, essentially. Now that's not quite right, that's the maximum number of steps. But for multiple steps, let's leave it like that, we take our weight matrix, we multiply it with itself multiple times, and that's delicate, as we shall see. Let's complete the derivatives. So now we know how to do these bits right. And if we basically chain things together or put things together, we can really spill out these terms, what they are. So now we understand that the derivative delta ht with regard to whh, it does involve the weight matrix itself because of the recurrent structure of this calculation. Just realize I haven't really written that out explicitly, whereas I should. So let me try. So delta ht with regard to delta whh, that equates to delta ht with regard to delta t minus 1. Times delta ht with regard to delta WHH. Again, where we then know that the letter part, the letter factor here, is the hidden state. Should have used colors or different colors here. And we do know that we do know that this bit basically results from that bit here. And this is how we construct these equations. And the key take home here is that when we do these equations, or when we do these calculations of our derivative, we see the weight matrix with a certain power occurring in the computations. And this is the, these can cause two types of problem that we are going to revisit next. But before so before doing so, let's try to summarize what we've learned here. Let's try to summarize our findings from looking at the computational graph and trying to write down all the partial derivatives that we need for a gradient update. And here's my attempt to do so. Okay, we've seen that an application of backpropagation to latent variable sequence models, that is what backpropagation through time is all about. And we have seen that it involves long chain of derivatives. Long change, where the sequence length does play a role. Let me use blue here, because here you really see this chain of derivatives. We have an index, here it's J, and we have capital T as the maximum length of our sequence. And if J is equal to 1, then for multiple steps, we multiply this matrix with itself. And that has a problem when we, that may cause a problem when the values within that matrix get too big or too small. And these two problems are called the gradient vanishing or gradient explosion problem, respectively. And in fact, you can prove that these problems are sort of guaranteed to occur whenever you have weights larger than 1, then you will eventually face gradient explosion. Or when you have weights larger, smaller than 1, you eventually will have gradient vanishing if this chain of computations is long enough. And you can find a proof in the paper I'm citing here if you are interested. But just intuitively, if you have many small values in this matrix and you multiply it with itself, they get smaller and smaller and smaller. So take a half, square it, you get 0.25, right? And this is the idea. This toy example shows you already how the values in this matrix will get smaller and smaller and smaller if we started from values less than 1 when we perform these computations many, many times, when the chain is actually very long. Now, in practice, it's typically not carried out from the starting point of the time series to the very end. Rather, you truncate the computation at some point. You just select some threshold arbitrarily for numerical convenience, well, to speed up computation. This is what I'm trying to say here. You terminate the chain of computations to accelerate it. And again, there is a paper by Telek and Olivier for some details should you be interested. But more interesting for us are these two types of problems that I want to detail in the following. Okay, once again, we have this calculation that when we do the partial derivative, the weight matrix of the hidden layer WHH shows up in this power term, where the exponent, it depends on the maximum length of the sequence and where in the sequence we are. Maybe the next picture helps a little bit to clarify that, this where in the chain we are. Here, I'm considering the case where we are working with the loss signal or the gradient signal that we obtain from the sixth output of our neural network, the last one, J6. Remember the previous chapter, we have maybe fed our neural network a sentence at every word in that sentence, making it predict the next word in the sentence. And here we are considering the last word in the input data, which triggered some forecast, Y hat 6. And this forecast is associated with some loss, as calculated by our loss function. And this loss is the starting point for the backward path. And now we feed back this loss information, or this gradient information, into the backward path. And what you see is that the magnitude of this information, it shrinks, it gets smaller and smaller the farther we go back in time. And that is exactly what I was referring to before. When we go further back in time, then the matrix WHH, it gets multiplied by itself again and again and again. And with every step we go back, we have one more multiplication of the weight matrix. This is exactly the essence of this equation here. And I do know that the indices are a little confusing or overwhelming at times, but in a nutshell, obviously it's a recursion, and here you really see what's going on. With every step, the gradient signal gets smaller and smaller. But bear in mind, this is because I'm considering the vanishing gradient problem. It's one of the two problems. So I'm considering that WHH has many elements that are less than one. And then in tendency, since there are less than one, the values, when we do these multiplications, that we obtain get smaller and smaller and vanish eventually. The gradient signal from far away is lost because of the repeated multiplications of the weight matrix when we apply the chain rule, which we do in backpropagation. That's one side of the problem, but in fact there is another side, which is that we don't only have a loss from the sixth output. As you see here in the picture, we have a loss from every single output. So when we update our weights, since the multiplications of WHH with itself are a lot less, when we consider the nearby loss, or when we consider nearby losses, loss signals from that are not so far away in this sequence, like this one here, then because of the structure of the derivative, these signals are a lot more prominent and they outweigh signals from, well, long-term effects or from far away. And far away is exactly what long-term is about. The dependence between x1 would be here, by the way, so here would be x1, if you think about it, and the dependent between x1 and here's y6, this dependence is very, very difficult for the recurrent neural network to discover, because the loss signal that we obtain from the network output, y hat 6, and how it is wrong, it shrinks every time we go back all the way, and we can't really understand the dependence between x1 and y6, which would be a long-term dependency, because the gradient vanishes, and also because when looking at the loss associated with our first forecast with the short-term dependency from x1 to y1 is far bigger. And this becomes this comes because of the structure of the gradient with the weight matrix up to certain power and just being multiplied with itself. And we can connect that back to our language modeling example. We could, for example, make the point that in a nutshell, the gradient is like a measure of how much the past affects the future, which is just another way to refer to a long-term dependency. And if this signal, this measure, if the gradient signal vanishes over longer distances between a point in time t and some later point t plus j, then we simply are unable to determine whether there really is no dependence between these two points, which might be the case. Machine learning is about learning from data, so it might be that there just is no dependence to be found, or it might be that there is a dependence, but that we cannot capture it. We can't detect it because we have the wrong parameters. And the gradient signal goes away and does not allow us to adjust our weights to pick up this dependence. And we remember this language example where we do have a long-term dependence between the start of our text, which made the point that somebody grew up in France, and where much later we need to make a prediction of a language that this person speaks fluently. And that is like before, x1 to y6. That's a long-term dependence. That's a long-term dependence. Every word is one step in our sequential data. We feed the network words, we let it output predictions for the next word, and we do that in this example, for a long sequence. If we feed the neural network the entire text, we have this long sequence, but because of the gradient vanishing problem, this long-term dependency will probably go unnoticed. And a neural network looking at that text, if you read that text, the answer, what comes for these three question marks, is obvious to you. But if a neural network reads this text, or a recurrent neural network, it tries to make a educated guess what language the person might speak fluently, because of the vanishing gradient problem, and because of this picture is really important, because of the structure of the derivative that lead to these effects when we do the gradient calculations. Because of that, the neural network is very likely to predict German, which semantically makes no sense. German proved difficult, but I speak fluent German. That makes no sense to a human, and a human would never make that prediction because of her or his understanding of the text. A recurrent neural network, however, has this tendency to overemphasize near-term effects over long-term effects, and might just be unable to discover long-term dependencies. If to further stress that, please note, in order to have any chance or to sustain any chance of picking up this dependence, I grew up in France, blah blah blah, I speak fluent, to have any chance to pick up this dependence, we would need to feed our RNN the entire sequence, including the beginning, I grew up in France. If we cut the text in smaller sequences, it will be even more difficult for the network to pick up that dependence. Well, I'm touching upon some technical details here that we will examine in the tutorial in more detail. But for now, you can take home that we do need to feed the network the long sequence to maintain any chance of picking up the long-term dependence, and working with long sequences, although theoretically possible, is sometimes delicate in its own right for computational reasons. We have to do that. And even if we do it and cope with all these computational challenges, even then, because of the gradient calculations, picking up long-term dependencies is hard at best. Another example of that, which I like a lot, comes from a paper by Linzen et al., where they make the point that RNNs are often a lot better at learning sequential recency rather than syntactic recency. And I like this example here. The writer of the books, and then you want the network to predict either is or are. The last word in the sequence was a noun, and then it's likely that the next word is going to be a verb. And even when we have these two choices, if we narrow it down to two choices, making the task really easy, the RNN will typically predict the next word to be are, so it will predict plural, because books is plural. And the plural would suggest that the next word is are, and that is sequential recency, because books is the last word the network has seen. Whereas the syntactic rules of language dictate that the next word is, because we are referring to the writer. But the writer, the word writer, is far back in our sequence, and thus the gradient signal is likely to be outweighted by that coming from the near term effect. And you can really see this pattern. To focus on sequential recency in RNN-based language models, or also in systems that generate text based on an RNN approach, a vanilla RNN approach. We haven't yet talked about the more sophisticated RNNs that remedy these problems to a good extent. So, right, that was the vanishing gradient problem. And it's the key problem, really. It's the most important problem, or the main challenge we need to solve. But I did mention also the problem of gradient explosion, where the weight matrix WHH has many values that are greater than 1, and not so many that are less than 1. And if we then repeat this calculations of WHH multiplied with itself, if we carry out this chain of computations, especially if we carry it out for a long time, for many steps, long sequences, then the weight matrix will get bigger and bigger, and this is what they call exploding. It will just get so large, it will get extremely large, which also makes sense. If you multiply small numbers with one another for long enough time, then you get very large numbers in the end. This is how interests work, if there are positive. And gradient explosion is a problem because it can impede the gradient updates. I put the update equation here, and if we update the weights of the hidden layer weight matrix, WHH, the update will just be take the previous weight, WHH, and then subtract from that the gradient of your loss with regard to WHH times some learning rate eta. And if we keep everything constant, especially the learning rate eta, then the magnitude of the update, how much we change our weights, depends on the magnitude of the gradient. If it's big, we make a big step. If it's small, we make a small step. And that can be a problem. Obviously, if a gradient explodes, it gets very, very big, so we make very, very big steps. Meaning that we might overshoot. Remember the overshooting problem, trying to highlight it here. The gradient. If we imagine we start from a larger value more on the right-hand side of W. Here, for example. The gradient is very small here, because our function, it's almost flat. If we imagine a tangent here, so yeah, very flat, very small gradient. So we will make only a very small step when we update the weights, a small step. And since the gradient remains small, we will continue making a sequence of smaller steps. At some point, however, we are reaching this cliff, where out of a sudden, we have a very large gradient. We have this large gradient, and This means that, just look at the equation, large gradient means we change our weights a lot. Possibly we go right to here. Oops, no. Right to here. So we overshoot, missing this nice sweet spot here where the loss is low, we overshoot. And even worse, in this stylized example, when we overshoot, we arrive at a point where the gradient is very, very large again. So we will once again make a very big step, just in the opposite direction. And that might bring us back to God knows where, straight back to here. Given the large gradient, we would make a big, big step. And if things get really bad and we do keep everything constant, that might be a... We might get trapped in the training process. We might get trapped in that. Imagine we are just back at a very large value for W, so we would again need to make small steps back until we eventually arrive at the cliff. But the gradient, once we arrive at the cliff, will again be very large, make a big step, and we would overshoot and then go back. So this could, in the worst case, go on for many steps, and this is what I mean when saying we might get trapped in our training. We make no progress. We always have some weight W, and then we lower that and lower that and lower that all the way to W prime, but then we overshoot and go back to W. And that could go on and on and on and on. That is getting trapped in the training. And gradient explosion is a possible origin of that problem. In my graph, the origin was the big cliff, which is dangerous because gradients will get large. But the loss surface does not have to look like that because of the problem of gradient explosion in recurrent neural networks, which again is a problem that emerges because of the structure of the derivative and these weight matrix exponentiated. We could face the problem that we make these enormously big steps in our gradient updates simply because this multiplication makes the gradient so large, makes it explode. However, it's not such a crucial problem. It's good to understand it, which is why I'm stressing it, but it's not that dramatic because we can just check the magnitude of the gradient before calculating the update and impose a threshold where if the gradient gets too big and our step would be too big, whatever is too big, that is a metaparameter, we would need to pick some threshold, we could just avoid that step and scale down the gradient. So if we walk down this hill and out of a sudden detect, oh dear, big gradient, be careful, we could just clip it and say, no, we won't make that step. Okay, the gradient is still big, I continue walking that way, but I'll scale down the gradient and then make a little bigger step, but not too big, to not overshoot. That's easy. Doing that is very easy, just clipping the gradient. And therefore, gradient exploding is not the really big problem. Gradient vanishing is a more severe problem. If the gradient vanishes, if it's zero, you can't multiply a zero with a big number to make it bigger. The gradient will remain zero and you won't know where to go, in which direction to update your weights. So gradient vanishing is really the problem we need to focus on. And more advanced recurrent neural networks like the gated neural RNNs that we are going to explore next are the ones that try to address this problem of gradient vanishing.